Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Oh, man.
All right, we have four public speakers that have signed up for during the public comment session for the night, and which will be 3 minutes apiece. The first is Mr. James Allen.
Evening, Chairman, Commissioners. Thank you. Thank you for leading our county into unknown waters and doing it smoothly. I'm here as a representative of Burlington Velo Club. We are a local cycling club based out of Gibsonville. We've been a club since 2009, and we started out with a small group of members that paid a charter and started wanting to share the joy of cycling throughout Alamance County. We are sponsored by some well-known entities in Alamance County, LabCorp, Alamance Regional Medical Center, Hall Tire, Fat Frog Bar and Grill, Conklin Oil, or just to name a few. We have about 50 active riding members right now. We have 375 members on our Facebook page that kind of come and go as they please. BBC created my position this year, the advocacy officer, to be more of an outreach and build a bridge between the club, our local government, and our community, both with the commissioners and with the Burlington City Council. Basically, we're trying to put a face to those of us that are on bicycles that you see out on the roads and in the county. And we know oftentimes we're just seen as a kind of a slow-moving object going down the road. So we're all fathers and sons and brothers and daughters and mothers, and we all want to get home safe, same as y'all. The Burlington Velo Club is a 501c4 club. Some of our charitable contributions we've done since our inception. We annually host for the last 5 years now a 200-mile endurance ride that starts here in Alamance County. We start at Alamance Regional, and we call it the Double Down to the Beach. We end somewhere on the coast of North Carolina. It's been Wilmington, it's been New Bern, it's been Myrtle Beach. And the money we raise through that opportunity, we take and give $1,000 scholarships to residents, students in Alamance County and Eastern Guilford County for their college tuition, for whatever they want to use it for. And we base those off of letters that they have to write to us on how they've served their community and how they're going to serve their community in the future. Some other charities that we've hosted and raised money for are Habitat for Humanity, Sustainable Alamance, Crossroads, the Sexual Assault and Response and Resource Center. We've raised over $4,000 for them and $4,300 for various charitable organizations through our ride programs. That's all I have.
Thank you, Mr. Allen.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Next we have Hugh Webster.
Chairman,
yes.
I'm going to shock you and surprise you today. First of all, I got the shortest speech you'll ever hear up here. Secondly, it's good. Ector Painting came Saturday and did a wonderful job of finishing up the inside of our office. And I'm anxiously awaiting the carpet to come. So, thank you.
Thank you.
And you're welcome to visit anytime you want to. Maybe as soon we won't be ashamed of what you say when you come in. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Webster.
James Harry.
Chairman, Commissioners, yes, first of all, I'd like to thank you for your service to the county.
The reason I'm speaking today is because there seems to be currently no process, or not a known process, for in place for contesting civil notice violations issued by the county. County employees seem to be well aware of what to do when you agree that you were in violation, but they don't seem to know what to do when you wish to contest. According to the language printed on a notice of violation I received, and I quote the following, you have the right to contest this action by filing a written request for a hearing with the Alamance County Attorney's Office no later than 30 days from the violation issuance. That's the end of the quote. However, keep in mind that that same document states that 217 College Street, which is currently a vacant lot, is where you pay your fines. So that part's wrong as well. I received a notice on August 3rd, and since then I have contacted the county attorney by phone and email several times, the district attorney two times, the planning department several times, the sheriff's department, and the Alamance County District Court Civil Division. None of these entities have been able to provide me with a process to contest a notice. Earlier today, I took a written request for hearing to the county attorney's office just so that there would be a record that I had complied with the instructions that were on the notice, even if those instructions were wrong. The county attorney refused to accept the request and returned it along with a printed copy of my email response to his most recent email to me explaining why I intended to contest. I can only assume the county attorney refused the request because by accepting it, he would have taken responsibility for something he wasn't responsible for, and I can't blame someone for not taking on additional responsibility. As stated above, my purpose for speaking is to point out this flaw in county policies concerning the ability to contest notice of violations. You know, one of the founding principles of this country is that people are assumed innocent until proven guilty. And lacking this process, we are violating this founding principle. So all I ask for is help to rectify this issue by coming up or directing me to a policy, not only for me, but for those in the future who feel they're falsely accused, as I feel like I've been falsely accused, and end up in a similar circumstance as myself. And that's all I have.
Thank you, Mr. Harris. Sammy Moser.
Thank you, Commissioners. Thank you for all your hard work that each of you do. I think Chairman Engel asked at the last meeting if anyone had any comments about whether to hold our meetings, maybe all meetings in the afternoon or not, or evening. I've thought about it, and I felt like more people possibly could attend an evening meeting than in the morning. And have a lot of really good group of citizens here this evening. And I was also thanking a lot of our school personnel who we're having a lot of close interaction with now. If they wanted to attend the commissioners' meetings, the morning meetings, it's going to be hard for them to meet during the school year. So I just thought if both meetings took place in the afternoon or evening, that might be better for our school personnel. One thing I thought about, though, if we go back to both meetings in the evening, what about our county personnel? They work all day long, and then they coming back and working again at night. So I just wonder if we do change the meeting, do we consider maybe making some type of compensation for working at night, maybe come in a couple hours later the next morning? Just something to think about. So I would be in favor, I feel like, of the both evening meetings. If that don't take place, would ask you to consider when we have public hearings, try to schedule the public hearings in the evening meeting. So okay. Thank you for your time and your hard work.
Thank you, Sam.
Thank you, Sam.
Comments from commissioners?
Well, I've got a comment to James's issue there, I guess, with Clyde. Can you kind of fill us in on what this is
sure.
about?
I'll be glad to. As I told Mr. Henry, he got an old form, an old citation. We changed the procedure on that. Their deputies, when they issue a citation, it's supposed to be a criminal citation. The only reason the corporal didn't issue a criminal citation is because Mr. Henry had cooperated with him. His dog got loose on 1/18/15. Pit bull, cat killed. Complainant, Ms. Young, said it was his pit bull. Deputy responded. On 1/20, the deputy said, well, that's a potentially dangerous dog because it's off its own property and killed a cat. On 1/23, Ms. Young called and said, hey, these two black labs and a white colored goat are on my property. They belong to Mr. Henry. It's the third trip out. On 8/3/15, she again called and said that two pit bulls got into her barn and attacked her horse inside the barn. When the corporal responded, the horse's belly was bleeding and the horse was limping. So he was issued a civil violation in the amount of $50 due to the dogs being off the property, and he'd already gotten a written warning. So I explained to him, here are your choices, pay the fine or go to district court. And I put all this in an email to him along with the reports, and those are his choices.
In other words, the appeals process would be for him to take it to district court.
To district court if he doesn't agree.
All right.
But in this correspondence I have from him, he said he fixed the hole in his fence and there haven't been any more incidents since then. So apparently it's resolved.
Any further?
Yeah, I think I want to clarify one thing. We've been getting some bad notices about Tony Cox. The copy of the letter, I think, that the county attorney sent Tony laid it out real good. A lot of people think that Tony was banned from even coming to the meeting for 6 months. We can't ban anybody from coming to these meetings. But we do have the ability to keep them from speaking for a while if they have disturbed our meetings and don't follow the rules. Now, folks, for those of you who've never used the booklet that we have, there's a sign-up sheet, and over on the left-hand side are all the rules listed. And all you got to do is read the rules and go by them. If you don't want to go by them, then, you know, we're probably going to have to do something like escort you out or something like that, like has been done before. But Tony, as far as I'm concerned, and I think the whole board's the same way, has not been banned from coming to these meetings.
Yeah, right.
Just that we don't want to hear from him for a while until hopefully he can, I'll say, behave and follow the rules.
Well, even to reiterate that, what Clyde said, he can speak in public comments for like incentives or other public hearings that come up that, you know, he has an issue with that subject matter.
Thank you. Thank you, Judge. Any further?
Yeah, on a lighter note, I would just like to thank James Allen for coming. For disclosure, I am a member of the Burlington Velo Club. I had nothing to do with him coming here tonight, though. But it's a good organization, and I appreciate you coming and letting us know about it.
Thank you. Further comments from commissioners? All right, approval of the agenda. Members, I'd like to amend the our agenda for the night. Just one amendment down in under number 7. I'd like to just add a 1A before 1. Sheriff Johnson would like to address the board when we come to that time. So that will be, do I have a motion that we approve the agenda as amended?
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you. Appreciate that. All right, our consent agenda. Any items to be pulled from the consent agenda by commissioners? Hearing none, do I have a motion for approval of the consent agenda?
I move the approval of the consent agenda.
All right, second. There's a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you. Okay, moving on to item number 7, 1A. Sheriff, you have the floor, sir.
Thank you. I wanted to come forward to the board tonight to say thank you to the sitting commissioners and Commissioner John Paisley, Tim Sutton, and Bill Lashley for standing with me in the Alamance County Sheriff's Department in our endeavor against the United States Department of Justice. I also want to thank publicly Craig Honeycutt, our county manager, Assistant County Manager Brian Haygood. And I'm going to tell you something, folks. These people, where's Ben at tonight? This young lady right here. Clyde, stand up. This man along with Chief Deputy Tim Britt and Mark Dockery, done three-fourths of the work on that lawsuit in this county. There were a lot of sleepless nights for everybody, a lot of hard work, and I hope we never forget that, because Clyde Albright actually drew the line in the sand in the early stages and never faltered. Now, you commissioners, y'all could have left me hanging out there, and you didn't. I would have sold my house, and I'd be bankrupt right now, but I would have never given in to the Department of Justice, because my people are fine people that work there, and they did not profile, and it's been proven. They're good people. Citizens of Alamance County, I want to thank all of them. They stood with us everywhere I went. The churches, a lot of prayers went out. And believe me, prayers work. We've got one that traveled all the way. Where you at, Sammy? Stand up. Sammy traveled all the way to Winston-Salem several days for the trial to give us support. And I won't ever forget this. And I want to thank all the department heads in this county that come and slap me on the back and say, Sheriff, hang in there. Don't give up. Because I'm going to tell you something. Had we given up, we'd have been paying millions of dollars. And I knew that we were not guilty of what they were trying to accuse us of. And please, commissioners, as long as you sit on this board, stand with your department heads. And I think our department heads, if they were wrong, and I can tell you right now, if I was wrong, I'd have walked out of that sheriff's office. I'd have never embarrassed that badge. I can tell you that. And I just wanted to publicly thank each and every one of you. Nice note I got from you. Made my day. So thank y'all very much. David Smith, you stood with me when you was county manager, county attorney. I won't forget that.
He threatened to throw me out the window.
I will tell that. Thank all of y'all.
Thank you. All right, next we have on the agenda Kevin Leonard, Executive Director of the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners, and you have a presentation, sir, you'd like to.
I do. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Kevin Leonard with the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners, and it is a pleasure to be in Alamance County tonight.
Well,
thank you. Yeah. I'll say that we'll take all the time necessary to make this presentation tonight, but I am in a bit of a hurry. When I told my wife that I was heading this way yesterday, she said, well, that's great. I'll ride with you, and you can drop me off at the outlets. And so she's over there. She's over there right now with our two boys spending all of our money. So we're trying to spur the economy of Alamance County for you guys.
That's why we keep the sales tax local.
I set that one up. Yeah. I'm not here to talk about sales tax, but no, thank you very much for having me. And we're busy preparing in Raleigh for our annual conference, which will happen later this week in Pitt County. We've been on the phone with Craig. I know y'all are proud of Craig and his leadership. He's getting ready to take over the management of the County Managers Association, and so we've been working this week on getting that set. But I'm here tonight to brag on one of your own, and Jamie Hamlet has been recognized by her peers across this state, and I think this is probably one of the best things I get to do in my job, and we should highlight these things in front of our boards as many times as we can. Because I know y'all deal with all kinds of issues, but this is one of the best things that we get to do as leaders. And that is for me to thank you for investing in our future and our future leaders in North Carolina. Let me tell you what you've done, whether you realize it or not. Y'all have invested in the County and City Administration course, which is run by the School of Government. And that's a commitment. And Jamie and her family made a commitment to serve there. Let me describe for you what she has gone through, because I can tell you I went through this class myself. It's a year-long program. Imagine 100 people from all over the state. You're talking about county attorneys, county managers, department heads that the sheriff just talked about, all assembled for 1 week. every month. They take a trip to live in Chapel Hill while they go through this course. Not only are you learning about city and county government and the partnership that happens when these when city and county governments work together, but you get the benefit of networking with and making friends with people all across the state, friends that and colleagues that you'll have for the rest of your career and your life. Now, that's quite a commitment to do that. Jamie was recognized by her peers. They voted at the end of the course to recognize one of their own. And your own Jamie Hamlet here in Alamance County was recognized as the top student in the county class. And that's saying something. So it is my honor to be here tonight to tell you that we recognized her there at the graduation ceremony, and I had the pleasure of presenting her with her certificate and her check. The North Carolina Association of County Commissioners presents that person with a cash award, a check, and it's for the Edwin M. Gill Award. And if I may let you know what that award is and just a little brief description about it. And then I, Mr. Chairman, don't want to take over your agenda, obviously, but I know that her supervisor is here, Ms. Susan Osborne, and I know if she might want to say brag on her a little bit too, if that's okay with the board. But the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners presents the Edwin M. Gill Award to a deserving student completing the county administration course every year. And the award was given first in 1965 and is a memorial to Edwin M. Gill, who served as chairman of the Local Government Commission and as state treasurer from 1953 to 1978. We announced it, as I said, at the graduation ceremony, and we will also announce this at our annual conference coming up later this week, and recognizing one of your own in Alamance County. So with that, it is just my pleasure to congratulate her, and it is so worth the drive coming from Raleigh and be with you in Alamance tonight to recognize Jamie, and I just want to say congratulations.
So when I think about Jamie, and she's been working with us at Social Services for more than 12 years, I think about three words, passion, commitment, and dedication. If you recently read a wonderful article done by the Times News about real people, her peers in the court system, our judges talked about Jamie. She works 24/7, as you know, our job at DSS requires sometimes. There's never a time that I have called Jamie that she hasn't, you know, put aside her own family life. Her girls could attest to that, as could Jody, and really dedicated to the needs of our county and the citizens that we serve. So we're very lucky in Alamance County to have the caliber of a local social services attorney of Jamie Hamlet and her commitment to stay with us for more than 12 years. So I thank you.
Thank you.
So I was just going to say thank you, but Susan said I had to say something more. And I can talk a lot, so get comfortable. I actually am getting a page right now that I'm needed for a foster child, but there's nothing I can do, so. Honorable Chair and esteemed County Commissioners, thank you for taking the time out of your busy schedule to recognize me. I would also like to extend my thanks to Mr. Leonard and the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners for sponsoring the Edward Gill Award and supporting the Municipal and County Administration course at the UNC School of Government. It was a great honor first to be chosen to attend the course, because you do have to apply for it. And it was a wonderful surprise and honor to be chosen for the Edward Gill Award. I had to do everybody's homework. Greg Allison and Alicia Insarara run the program, and they do a great job of administering the program. The county offered me a great opportunity to increase my knowledge and hone my skills and increase my contacts by attending this course. By better understanding the legal framework and administrative requirements of North Carolina county government, I can better serve the county and its citizens. And sometimes the benefits of networking go underestimated. However, being part of a broader network of local government peers gives me a pool of individuals from which to draw. And this has already come in handy when I've had questions or when other peers have had questions and we've been able to discuss the issues. I've had the great honor to work with Ms. Osborne for over 12 years. She is an innovative leader who aspires to assure the highest quality of services are rendered to the citizens of Alamance County through DSS. She challenges me to be a better lawyer, and she affords me the opportunity through learning experiences of this nature. My peers are top tier, and they're hardworking individuals who are a joy to work with, and each and every one of them supported me in taking this course. I'd like to give a special thanks to Ben Pierce, who covered court for me about once a month so that I could attend, and of course, my esteemed colleague, Mr. Albright, who permitted me, Mr. Pierce, to help me. Thank you, Clyde.
You're welcome.
I also enjoyed talking to Clyde. I always love his stories. I'd also like to thank my legal staff, Terry, Joe, and today it's Erica Bluford. Then it was Liz Klein. They make me look good and they keep me organized. And I think it goes without saying it takes some special people to work with me. In addition to my legal staff, I'd like you guys to know that the line workers and the supervisors are the ones who do the hard, back-breaking work and sometimes heartbreaking work that their jobs require every day. It's their high-quality work that makes it easy for me to represent them in court. I do not think I can say enough that the county employees who put themselves on the line every day to assure the safety and well-being of our most vulnerable citizens need to be thanked. They are the ones who truly deserve an award and recognition for their services to our citizens. Of course, I want to thank my family, who have always been a tremendous support to me and were no less so when I told them I wanted to attend this course. They understood the need for me to work extra prior to and after sessions and to study during the evenings. In fact, there were a few times when my oldest daughter told me she was having trouble sleeping and I would simply read my homework assignments to her. I'm truly blessed by God to be here and employed by my position. We are instructed to do all things as if doing it for the Lord, and I truly endeavor to give my best to the county in everything that I do, and it is an honor to serve the citizens of Alamance County. Again, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity and thank you for this time, as well as Mr. Leonard and the North Carolina Association County Commissioners.
Thank you.
We have, Mr. Chairman, we have several other leaders in this room who have taken the same course. Susan, I think Susan
yes.
took it. Chief Deputy Tim Britt took it, and our Assistant County Manager took it.
So, well, and I meant to mention that Hal Scott Jr. also won this award. So right. It was when I saw his name listed, like, it brought that? Tears to my eyes to know that he was recognized as well.
We got a lot of smart people now.
We do.
Got
some good people.
Thank
I
you.
Took it 20 years ago.
Well, you weren't here then.
Yeah. So I was a city guy then. So.
Congratulations to you, Jamie. Thank you.
Quite
thank
an
you.
Award.
Appreciate it. All right.
Thank you, Kevin.
Next item's Fawcett Township Volunteer Fire Department and North Central Alamance Fire Department improve ISO ratings. Jamie and her family are heading out. I actually went to school with her at Elon, but I was very, very non-traditional. Put on that. Goodbye. We took a government course where we actually set up a government Camelot. It was a city and set up a government in public administration. A lot of fun. Welcome, sir.
Chairman, Commissioners, my name is John Payne, Deputy Fire Marshal for the Alamance County Fire Marshal's Office. Just a little background on ISO and what it can do for us as citizens here in Alamance County. ISO stands for Insurance Service Organization. This is a group of trained professional evaluators that assess almost every fire department we have in the United States. ISO uses a consistent set of guidelines to evaluate every fire department. It bases a fire department's rating on many factors, including the number of personnel on duty at any given time, the training level for our personnel paid and volunteer, the amount of water that our fire trucks can haul from scene to scene, the amount of quality equipment such as fire trucks, hand tools, air packs, fire gear. The purpose of an ISO rating is to give insurance companies a uniform system on which to base their insurance premiums. For an insurance company, knowing the capabilities of a fire department is important. The better the fire department, the better protected a building is from fire damage and loss. The higher the level of protection in our fire departments here in the county, the less likely an insurance company will have to reimburse a claim for fire damage. The inspection is conducted by the NC Department of Insurance, DOI as we call it, as required by the North Carolina Response Rating System. This inspection usually takes up to a week to complete, as every aspect regarding fire prevention, suppression, inspections, and investigation is evaluated by the inspector himself. The purpose is to determine all capabilities of the fire department, the staffing levels, the training, the mandatory training exercises and drills. They determine the use of the equipment, the shape of it, the apparatus, the hoses, the nozzles, even down to the gear that they wear into the fires. The maintenance of the equipment also falls under the same thing as far as what they don't want to go into a burning building with non-suffice equipment. The communication capabilities are also evaluated by Alamance County Communications. The ratings are from 1 being the highest to a 10, which is not recognized by the state as a certified fire department. Insurance savings for $150,000 home. The insurance rating of a 6 would be $607 a year. Insurance rating of a 5 would be $566 a year, a savings of $41 per household. The supporting agencies that assist this inspection are Alamance County SECOM, which they assess their dispatchabilities, the call receiving and call dispatching in a timely manner, the equipment within communications, Alamance County GIS, they printed the fire district maps and also the water points on those maps, the surrounding fire departments and the mutual aid agreements throughout the county, the fire marshal's office, as we provide pump and ladder testing and fire inspections and investigations for that jurisdiction. The different ratings for the county are AO Station 2 has an ISO rating of 6, Eli Whitney Station 5 has an ISO rating of 6, Elon Fire Department has a rating of 4 inside the city limits, 5 outside. Hall River Fire Department has a rating of 5. E.M. Holt has a rating of 7. Mebane has a rating of 3 inside, 5 outside the city limits. Northeastern Alamance, which we call Pleasant Grove, is considered a 7. Snow Camp ISO is a 7. Swepsonville was 5 inside and 6 outside. The new insurance ratings just came out about a month ago, and I'd like to recognize Fawcett Fire Department. They reduced their rating from a 6 to a 5, and North Central reduced their rating from a 7 to a 6. At this time, I would like to recognize the following fire chiefs from Station 7, Deputy Fire Chief Corey Langley, and from Station 13, Chief Joe Chandler, and members of their boards.
John, I have something for both the Assistant Chief and Chief Fawcett, and also the Chief at North Central I'd like to present to them. Just for clarity, ladies and gentlemen, Fawcett actually went from a 7 to a 5. And I saw you shaking your hand, Chief, so we got that covered. But let me present this to you. This is from the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, and it is a certificate of recognition that is proudly presented to the Fawcett Township Volunteer Fire Department Incorporated and also the North Central Alamance Fire Department Incorporated. For your department's respective department's achievement in improving your fire suppression rating, which lowers the property insurance for the citizens in your response area. We commend your department's efforts and commitment to making the community a safer place to live. Presented this 17th day of August 2015, signed by all five of the commissioners. Congratulations and thank you for a job well done.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
This board is proud of all of our volunteer fire departments and just the amount of work. It's a tremendous amount of work that our men and women put in and volunteering just to keep us safe. And again, I thank all of you. We really appreciate it. Thank you. All right, next we have item number 3. It's ABSS funding request, bond money, 2006 bond money. Dr. Thor. Well.
Thank you, Chairman Engel. Thank you, Board of Commissioners. Let me start off by just saying thank you for your support. Thank you for what you do for our students, and our students are very excited about some of the changes. I've had the opportunity to bump into a few of them at the schools, and they are very excited about what they're seeing and the changes they're seeing in their school. I bring before you a request for $998,000 to complete additional projects throughout the school year. Seeking your permission.
Questions?
So moved.
Second.
Motion second.
I'd just like to acknowledge that we have several board members, Board of Education members here in the audience tonight. And I really appreciate them coming out, and just another sign that we have a good relationship going on between our two boards and for the benefit of our kids and our community as a whole.
And thank Todd for his hard work at working to put some of this stuff together. I appreciate your responsiveness that gets things back to us.
So just for clarification, we approved about $1 million earlier out of bond money, and this will be another almost $1 million, and then there still be about $700,000.
Well, $597,000 will be remaining.
Almost
$600,000. And again, that's the 06 bonds, and I think it's important for the public to understand that's money that's been sitting there since, 2006. It has not been spent. That was all, I guess, the Highland bond was the big one, the Highland and the renovations. So that is dedicated for that, and along with the interest with that, it must be spent on school construction, and renovations are covered and allowed under the bonds.
Well, I'm just happy to see it used, because we all know that we have a lot of needs, facility needs.
Yes, sir.
Now,
in our schools.
In this, is there any lottery money in this?
Not this request. And Susan just said that the what is left in the 597 is just the interest left from the bonds.
Yeah. So but there is lottery money available.
There is lottery money available as well.
Like
I think
another
we're
million
three million.
3 million.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Any further? We have a motion from the judge, a second from the vice chair. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thanks. Mr. Chairman, if I could thank Todd as well for his help in the facilities committee, the joint committee meeting that we've held with the school board. Todd has done a lot of work along with Dr. Harrison in getting that agenda and coming up with the PowerPoints, and I just want to publicly thank him for that as well.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate everybody's participation.
We had the opportunity to go into Graham Middle School. We had a meeting, our facilities board that we put together, and it's just amazing the transition from what it looked like until, the repairs have all, for the most part, been done at Graham Middle School, and it was just amazing to see the difference between, from the school from. I'd love to have a picture before and after, and I think Dr. Thorpe, you've got some just to see that. And so I think everyone that's on that committee. I know Mr. Moser sit on it, and again, Mr. Paisley, and just thank you again.
I believe Susan Roberts and I visited all the Graham schools that day, that rainy day that we went out and toured the schools, and they had some. It didn't look too good, so I can't wait to.
One of the things the principal there said that as the students came back, that they really took a different perspective and had a respect for the school. You could just see it from what had been done there, that it made them want to respect what they had and what they had received, and it just shows you that the endeavor that we're undertaking to get these things fixed, which we should, is a good thing. So and with that, we'll move on. But thank you again. Thank you. And thank board members, school board members, for being here. We appreciate you. Thank you for being here. All right. Item number four, discussion of Animal Shelter Facilities Committee. And we have Mr. Sam Hunt. And welcome. And also Ms. Vicki Hunt's here also with us tonight. Well,
and Jessica Arias is here.
And Jessica with
the director of the shelter.
Good to see Jessica Arias here, also with the shelter.
Thank you. We've got a picture here. This may not be what it actually ends up looking like, but it's it's something to hope for.
It's a concept,
look forward to. And it looks great, but I think Vicki looks better, really. That's the last thing I remembered about politics. Anyway, I'm Sam Hunt, and I'm glad to be with you. You know, I too thank you for your service. Public servants get criticized from time to time, but thank very seldom. But anyway, we appreciate the service to our county. We all do. I'm here tonight really, representing our animals, our homeless animals, and officially paused our Pet Adoption and Welfare Society. Vicki is actually the chair of our organization, and I told her that y'all would much rather hear from her than me. But I got overruled, but I promise you, you'll have the second team only for tonight. In the future, we'll get Vicki here to do the talking. My purpose is to tell you, and I think some of you have received, did they put them out? Yeah, got them in front of you there. Mm-hmm. You had received a copy of that earlier, I think.
Yes, sir, we did.
But it's our proposal to have a shelter replacement study committee. The purpose of is to develop a consensus in determining our needs. There's been a good bit of work done on our needs. Y'all had a joint meeting I was privileged to be at, and you talked some about it. To determine the actual cost, that's not totally known now. Different numbers are thrown about. And then to make recommendations on funding, which of course would only be recommendations. I will say that Paul's, our organization, will be involved. We will be given a significant donation, and we'll be raising money. So we want to be part of the equation. You know, I think everybody agrees that we need our shelter needs replacing. And I think this committee will sort of develop that in a way that we can all have a pretty good plan to go forward. I think the brochure that you have in front of you says it best. It says the deed is great and the time is now. You can see this shelter was built in the early 60s. You see there our current pet adoption center, which we built in 2004. And actually the same formula that we're proposing here was what we did on the pet adoption center. We had a study commission. There were two county commissioners that participated at that time, and we raised some money from the county. Y'all were kind enough to do your share. The city did their share, and then with the public, and through Paul's, we came up with a good amount of the money. And it's been a success, and we've had the spay-neuter clinic came on in 2010. But now we really have an out-of-date. I know that Commissioner Byrne went over there, I think, and we're actually doing a video tomorrow to have for our committee to show that, and hopefully we'll be able to go and visit it during one of our meetings. But it's pretty much a disgrace, about all you can say. It's outlived its usefulness. I think we all agree that it needs replacing, and then how we're going to do it is the question. In your brochure you had, we put a survey that we did back in, I think we did this before 2004, but anyway, we just saw what the public thought about it. And on page 4, interestingly enough, there's a question on there about the public. 89%. Support having a proper shelter. I think that this shows the public support. Back in those, this was 15 years, about 11, no, this was done in 2001. That's when we first started talking about it. So 15 years ago almost. And I would say today, listening to the news and the public and all that we probably have more support today than we did then. And so anyway, we're hoping that you will participate in this and endorse it. And our so far, I mean, who we're planning to have. If we don't have y'all, we can't have it. So let me just say that right now. And I've been telling people I felt like y'all would do it, so don't make me out, you know.
We don't want to do
and
that.
And the sheriff, you know, the sheriff has agreed to be on the study. And he does a great job for our animals, I must say. He's a real champion. But hopefully we have two from this board, and hopefully you'll let the county manager be a member. We certainly need him. Two from the Burlington City Council, city manager from Burlington, one from Graham, Elon, we hope Mevin, the Burlington police chief, Smythe, Perry and Lisa Nichols, you all know them, Bill Smith, Jess Harris, who is our shelter director, Anita Smith, Vicky and I, and Kelly Renault, who's the director of the Humane Society of Alamance County. So we have a good selection, and so tonight my appeal is to you to appoint two members that Craig, give Craig permission to serve, and then we will get started. Nothing's been decided. We don't know anything, but we have some ideas, and we'll welcome everybody's suggestion and opportunity to be involved. I will show you in the back of your brochure, this little fellow was our poster boy back in 2003 before we built it. So I'm sure he's gone to the, you know, on to the beyond, but we're still using him because he is one key thing, and he's giving you a message here tonight. Help us get a new shelter. So anyway, I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Any questions?
Well, I have a question for maybe Craig or Clyde. I mean, I think that an animal shelter is certainly in the interest of the public good. But isn't there also a legal requirement for the county to either provide a shelter or make sure it's provided? And yeah. Different counties do it differently, I understand. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
So in our county, it's really the city who is, it operates under the auspices of the city, but still has funding from the county and as well as from PAWS and other organizations.
We budget about $370,000 a year. That was what this year's budget was, and it was about a 15% increase over last year. But that was what we've budgeted, and our responsibility in working with the sheriff's department. And yes, it is our responsibility. And Burlington has been the lead agency for ever, but it is a county responsibility.
And that's as dictated by legislation.
Statue. Yes, sir.
But you know, we want everybody to come together on this, and I think that's always the best way.
Community involvement.
I think we're
key.
Fortunate yeah. that we have. It's yeah. not just the county that's taking it on; it's a collection of different organizations and people. So that's good.
Any further questions? I would like to just by consensus, board approve myself and also Vice Chairman Boswell for this committee. If that's okay with the rest of you. Sound good, Judge. That sounds good with you.
That's good. That's good news to the animals.
So we need to start figuring when our first meeting will be.
Yes. Yes. Well, yeah. All right. Thank you,
well,
so
sir.
Much.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank
appreciate
you, Mr.
it.
Thank you.
All right. Next on our agenda, we have Burlington Fixed Route Transportation Update, and Mike Nunn's filling in for City Manager Owen, who had a death in the family.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. Yes, he's not able to be with us. His brother has passed away.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me tonight.
Yes, sir.
Just another brief update. I think I've seen several faces over the last few months. Hope you're not getting too tired of me. But instead of talking about our planning and our process, we're actually going to implementation. As you see on the screen there, we've worked on four routes for the fixed route urban system. Burlington and Gibsonville will be the partners initially, as we stand today. And you just see the different colored routes there, the blue route, of course, going from down, everything going from downtown Burlington out into the community, all the way to Gibsonville, out to the Alamance Crossing, the Regional Medical Center area. The purple route goes up into the Walmart area, and then the green route just to the Glen Raven area, and everything comes back basically on a 45-minute headway. And if you were to get on downtown, you'd ride 45 minutes to the very end of the route. The route would turn around and come back for 45 minutes. And that would operate basically from 5:30 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. Monday through Friday to start with. Our goal right now is to begin operations in early summer, possibly June, maybe May of next year. We have two hurdles to overcome. We have to release a request for proposals for a service provider. The service provider will come in and provide all the employees. They will maintain the equipment, drive the routes daily, do all the testing, and basically, you know, operate the entire system. It's done commonly around the nation. Our partners to the east and the west use service providers in their public systems already. We also will be going out for a bid for equipment. The city of Burlington will own the equipment. We'll get anywhere between 5 to 7 light transit vehicles. Those will be about 28 foot in length. Just tonight at the council work session, the name and branding package was released, and you'll probably see that tomorrow in the media and maybe on the website tonight. Link, L-I-N-K, Link Transit, really fed off of what the community involvement was, connecting people, linking places, not just our community you see there, but we're also going to have connections to the regional systems in the Triangle area, Raleigh, Durham, Chapel Hill. We'll also have links to connections back in the Greensboro, Winston-Salem, High Point area. So it will serve our community, as you see there, but you'll also be able to go to both regions. So that'll be out most likely tomorrow. Just went to City Council this evening. I'm here to answer any questions about that and any details, but that's where we're sort of on a launch period right now. I've had some discussions about possibly a fifth route that would serve Graham downtown area and out to ACC. You will notice lightly, if you can see that dotted line and you see ACC all the way out to the east, the park and ride lot I mentioned, PART, the Piedmont Authority for Regional Transportation, that's where they will be coming in our area to the hospital. They're building a new, in the process of building a new lot there right now. Anyone wanting to go to ACC as it exists right now would ride the system red, blue, purple, green to ARMC, get off there and get on a PART bus and take them to the ACC campus. That's only going to happen twice in the morning and twice in the evening. It's a regional route. It's not a fixed route. Okay, so the goal there most likely would be able to improve that frequency out to the community college and get that service there and possibly where we are right now, if that's something that wanted to be explored. We've been very fortunate to have United Way to come in and participate with financial donation to assist with the system, and this possibly could be something to help out. But we're at a decision point, and that's sort of why we're here tonight, just to update you and discuss it. As I mentioned, we'll go out for a service provider. They need to know how many routes they're serving. We'll also go out for equipment, so we need to know how much equipment we're buying. So we're at a sort of a critical jumping off point to get that started. And I can answer any questions that you may have.
Questions?
Well, now, if it were a route coming to Graham, would it maybe connect to the park lot?
Possibly. Yes, exactly. That's another possibility. So you could have a connection from the new hospital park and ride route, the Graham park and ride route, and then also the Mebane park and ride route is further.
Which this part in Graham, a lot of people go to Chapel Hill out of that. It's it looks like it's full.
It's one of the highest used park and ride lots in their system. So that's a good possibility. Another point is, if that fifth route were added, just like we've worked with Gibsonville and Burlington, we've worked together on those stops. They're not already set, but we just want to be where people want to be. Park and ride lot, downtown area, of course, ACC.
Who are the partners that on this fifth route? Have you had any interest from other Graham or any other?
Just the same thing, just information and interest, and could we make it a partnership to where it serves both entities and get benefit and go to ACC? We really, just in theory, in a public transportation system, you want to go to your community college, just like you want to go to your hospital.
It's like a missing link there. I mean, it's looking at that.
Well, it's important from an economic development standpoint that people can attend there, and a lot of people don't attend, from my understanding, the community college because they don't have the transportation worked out.
Correct. We did lengthy public involvement and asking agencies and questions. That was one of the big barriers to get, was actually getting transportation there consistently.
As far as the funding of this, My understanding is that on the equipment, the capital costs, 90% comes from the federal government, the other, it's 5% from the state DOT, and then 5% by way of a local match.
Correct.
And then Burlington and Gibsonville, well, Burlington's doing their local match with a $5 per year vehicle registration fee plus some out of their general fund. Mm-hmm. And Gibsonville, I think, is doing it out of their general fund.
Correct.
But if it were going to go to other communities, then those communities would need to come up with that local match, and I would assume that would be the case if we had a route going to ACC and through Graham.
Right. The way we set it up now is that the mileage inside the cities, basically the hours per service, is how Gibsonville is paying for their service. Right. The equipment, the city of Burlington is going to own it. With this being an additional route, that's the 5% local match will come into play, and then the operations of the route.
And that's 50% on the operation.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
So 50% of the operating costs are paid for from local money.
Right, and 50% are from the federal grant. That's correct.
So I suppose that United Way money could be considered as part of local match to expand a service. The
correct.
Service.
Right. Correct. Yeah, if you had the partnership of county, city, and the United Way, you could collectively do that to match those funds. And it's 50% of the operations. We estimate for all the routes, estimation is about $120,000 until we get started to find out what it actually costs. It's a 12-hour-a-day operation, Monday through Friday. So
that fifth route, if that were to happen, how much local money would be required?
Probably 60 to 70 based on the operations.
60 or 70,000 per year?
For the operations.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
Further questions? Comments? Not this time. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
We'll be talking again.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Next we have Brian Haygood, Performance Management Program Policy Revision. Welcome, sir.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
I'm here this evening to present to you proposed changes to the county's performance management policy and ask that you review them and approve them tonight. Our current policy that we're operating under was approved by the Board of Commissioners in April of 2012. We've operated under the current policy for two fiscal years, and we've had some thoughts about how to possibly make this policy better. So I put in front of you this evening a color copy of a handout, and also have it appear for the public to take a look at. I'm just going to walk through some of the changes. I've tried to summarize these changes on the information that you have. The current policy, we don't require the county departments set any goals to participate in the performance management policy. We've changed that. Departments have to set goals to be in the new version of the policy. We don't require that the goals are reviewed beyond, except for the county manager, before they come to the Board of Commissioners for you to approve. In this new policy, we're suggesting that a group of public and employees would come together to review the goals set by the departments before they go to management and come to you. In the current policy that we're operating under, the unassigned fund balance of the county must be at least 12% for any of the savings to be able to be retained by departments. The board mentioned a couple of months ago that you were interested, as our fund balance has become healthier, in seeing us change those percentages. We're preparing tonight to say that the unassigned fund balance for the county would have to be at 15%. That would be for partial implementation. That's where the county would take 25% of the department's savings at the end of the year off the top, put back in fund balance before we implemented any other part of the policy. We're also saying that the unassigned fund balance, in the current policy, unassigned fund balance has to be at 15% for it to be full implementation. Full implementation on the savings side is where a department can retain 100% of its savings. We would move that to 18% in the new proposed policy rules. In the old policy, how we're doing business now, all expenditures of savings require Board of Commissioner approval before the departments can go out and spend. We're proposing in the new model that the county manager may approve expenditures up to $5,000, but that does not include bonuses. Any employee bonuses would still come to the board, but smaller expenditures under $5,000, the manager would have approval to allow those himself. Under our current performance management policy, savings departments see can be spent on new equipment, vehicles, capital improvements, buildings, and employee bonuses. We've talked to department heads. We've gotten suggestions from them. What other items and things they believe savings would be reasonable to spend on. We've included these in the new policy. They include training opportunities. So there are some trainings, I think, like the school of government classes that tend to be a little expensive. The department heads are interested in being able to use savings to pay for those. Also, for paid interns or special grant positions, I think we're funding one now with the district attorney's office. We could use these funds, if you approve, to be able to pay for positions like that. Also, strategic planning efforts. If departments want to undertake a planning project, they could use savings to do that. And technology projects would also become a new approved use of departmental savings. Under the current policy, we don't have a specific timetable for when spending plans are presented to the board. In this new policy, we're saying that we come before you in September, November, March, and May. Now, the original information I sent you said June, but that is just a little too close to the end of the fiscal year. So we would we've changed that to May. That's when anything over $5,000 that departments want to spend, or employee bonuses, when we would bring those plans to you for your approval, so you would have the opportunity to review them. Also, in the current policy, department heads can select to use some of their savings to give employees bonuses. There is no requirement for a minimum number of goals to be completed by the departments to do that in the current policy. We're suggesting that we change that to say, if a department wants to give bonuses to employees, they must have successfully completed at least 75% of the goals that they presented to you as part of the program. I wanted to also show you a slide here. It's also in your handout about how we calculate savings for departments. You know, when you approve a budget, the county department gets the budget for the year. They are authorized to spend every dime. We hope that this program will encourage them to think even more about how they spend their money if they're able to retain some of the savings at the end of the year. So how will we calculate the savings? We'll look at the end of the year, we get our audit. We have to wait for the audit to come in so the numbers are official and finance feels comfortable about it. We look at the overall actual revenue according to the audit. We subtract from that revenue any variance, which is usually more money. We brought in more money than what we predicted. We take that out. We don't want to give credit as savings to departments for money that came in above and beyond in revenue. Then we also subtract overall expenditures by the county departments. That's the first level of county department savings. Then if we set a fund balance percentage that you want us to target, if we're not at that fund balance percentage, we will take 25% off that that savings figure and have the final departmental savings, which I'm calling county department savings two. You can see these are all numbers confirmed by the audit. There's no way under this model that we could spend fund balance. County Board of Commissioners sometimes budget fund balance to balance the budget. I think sometimes could be several million dollars. If we had to spend that money, this program would be off. There would be no savings to come back to departments. Then what we do is we take the departments, we pool the savings into one pool. We look at the percentage of total county government budget for a department. So let's say Recreation Department was 2% of the overall county budget. They'll get 2% of the savings. But then we also subtract any money for missed goals, any percentages. So that's how we measure the individual department savings. So I know this was kind of a quick overview, but I hope you've had an opportunity to look at this, and I'll take any questions. Hope tonight to get you to approve this, but all the parts of the policy are on the table for you to review, approve, or not approve. So,
well, can I ask a question about Susan? Our fund balance as a percent of our operational expenses, what?
Right now, we are currently at 17.13%, and that's based on the 2014 audit. That number can change every year because it's based upon the total of expenses that we have.
So do you have an idea what it might be for the end of 2015, or June 30?
At this point in time, I do not, because our numbers are still moving. We're still having accruals through the end of this year, through the end of this month, actually. So I'm hoping to, by the middle of September, those will have stopped, and I'll know exactly where we will be for 15.
And what is the percent of fund balance in counties of our size across the state?
Normally, for ones our size, it's running around anywhere from 24 to 30%, 24 being the low end.
And should we have a target in that range for our fund balance?
Eventually, yes, yeah. Because that would get us into really good standing in case there were an incident where we would have to rely on fund balance versus tax money coming in, sales tax coming in, we would have the reserves. State statute says that we have to have at least 8%, which is 1 month's operating expenses.
So we're way above that.
So everything that we have, every 8% we have above that is an additional month of operation.
Okay, and so it seems to me that, what is the total fund balance right now approximately?
The actual total fund balance, assigned, unassigned, everything together is running, here with me just 1 minute, is at 31.4 million. Our unassigned fund balance is 21.5, which has given us the 17.13%.
Okay, so it's that one that counts.
That's the one we look at.
17.
And that's the fund balance we have the most flexibility
right,
with.
17%. The 21.5 million is at 17%.
Okay, right. So it seems like we ought to align at least that amount or something. We ought to align a target.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if we say we want our fund balance to be at 25%, I mean, that might be a pretty high target to establish right now since we're pretty far away from that. But mm-hmm. But pick a target, and then we align, like where it says if the fund balance is at 18%, then the full cost sharing is implemented there.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd be in favor of aligning it with some sort of a target where we really want our fund balance to be, because it's...
Because we're almost there now.
How about the partial implementation, 17%, and then the full implementation, 20%? That would be better.
And
I think that would be... If that doesn't compromise,
I think that's a very good idea as well. We didn't want to jump as a staff all at one time, but I think it is important for us to have those goals. The other thing that I think is important about this is that this can be adjusted at any time. You know, this is the reason why we come back and change. If we look at 20 and 20 is not high, or 20 is too low next year, you know, those percentages can be changed and adjusted, whatever is in our best situation. I believe we're going to be closer to the 20 for the 14-15 fiscal year once the final numbers are in.
And we would, any changes that you implement this evening, we would apply to 14-15.
Right.
So we've done two fiscal years. This would all happen for the budget year we just completed.
So changing the partial to 17% rather than 15%.
Right.
Changing the full implementation from 18 to 20% in
terms
of proposed policy. And then any other changes that any of the board members see needs to be made in the proposed policy, or any other comments before we vote on this?
And again, this would allow, as we talked about at budget time, the grant position we have with the DA to be funded from the savings from the Sheriff's Department.
Right. Which ought to generate more savings.
Right.
We're hoping
it does.
hearing no further comments, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the proposed policy changes in the performance management policy changes. That's redundant, but anyhow, as amended, with the two amendments being the partial implementation being 17% and the full implementation being 20%.
I'll second that, sir.
Have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Propose no.
No.
Thank you. No? All right, we have one no. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think that's a tremendous that puts a pretty good burden on the employees to really do good. Which is where they should be. So I think it's appropriate. But with that being said, I also say this: thank you, employees, for the job you do.
They can rise to the occasion.
All of you,
well,
you do a great job.
And Mr. Chairman, in looking at it, this, really goes back to a performance management tool, because before we were not requiring our departments to meet a specific amount of goals.
Yeah.
This will say you've got to produce to receive any savings. So if they don't meet their goals, then they may not qualify, or if they don't follow up with reporting, they may not qualify, so that all that money would then revert back to fund balance.
Well, we've just taken it from the old board had a 12% partial implementation and a 15% full implementation, and this board, current board, just took it to 17 and 20%, and I think that's appropriate.
And Mr. Chairman, if I could also mention, and thanks to Susan and her staff, is if we remember about 3 years ago, we got a letter from the local government commission, and our undesignated fund balance was at 7.6%. So to be almost at 20%, or depending on what the final numbers say, within a 3 year time frame, really has a lot to do with our employees and the effort that they've given and their commitment to saving and budgeting the best that we can. And I want to thank Susan and her department as well.
And none of this money gets paid out and or retained by the departments unless we're adding to the fund balance. Anyway.
Yes, if we're not adding to the fund balance.
So it's an incentive to add to the fund balance, which is what I like about it. And doesn't having an increasing fund balance lower borrowing costs if we have
the
to
bond
borrow?
Per
bond rating. That impacts our bond rating.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. All right. Next on the agenda, item number 8, County Attorney's report. DOJ update. Please do, sir. Thank you.
Sheriff, you mind taking that from me?
This is the opinion, all 243 pages. I won't be reading it tonight.
Thank you very much.
The real key to winning a lawsuit, and this is a monumental lawsuit, sometimes obscured by misconception, and perceiving them correctly can lead to a giant size or Goliath size advantage. The DOJ operated under the misconception that the sheriff was guilty. That's how they started. They failed to take a close look at the documents provided by us, and there were hundreds of thousands of documents. The Alamance County Sheriff's Office, since I've known them and grown to know them so well over the last 5 or 6 years, I've found them to be dedicated, well-trained individuals who enforce the law fairly and evenly, without regard to anybody's race or ethnicity. And our files and documents that we produce have proved this fact to the court and to all that have bothered to read them. This entire investigation by the DOJ began as an attempt to defeat the sheriff at the polls and to eliminate the 287G program, beginning in November of 2009, when DOJ opened a preliminary inquiry into the allegations that the sheriff's office was engaged in a pattern of practice of discriminatory law enforcement activities. As part of this inquiry, DOJ met and talked with members of Fairness Alamance. Fairness Alamance is a group formed to challenge Sheriff Johnson over 287G in the Alamance County Jail. DOJ's involvement with the members of Fairness Alamance dates back to at least September of 2008. During February of 2009, members of Fairness Alamance worked with the ACLU in presenting a local panel discussion at Elon University. The sheriff was invited to attend and be on the panel. We've learned from the emails we received that the statistics were not as favorable as the ACLU would like, so Ms. Catherine Parker, then director of the ACLU, and you remember her,
yes, I
Ms. Massey, she wrote to the members and said, instead of worrying right now about enforcement, I think y'all should focus on embarrassment. Let's go to the meeting. Keep the stats non-disclosed until the presentation, at which time we'll present them with no notice. So following an April 10th, 2010 meeting with Fairness Alamance, on June 2nd, 2010, I received a letter indicating that the DOJ was going to initiate an investigation of the sheriff, alleging discriminatory policing, unconstitutional searches and seizures, by the members of the sheriff's department. Following this announcement, Fairness Alamance assisted the DOJ by coming to Alamance County and speaking to 4 English as a second language classes at ACC, sending out an email to its members seeking persons who experience racial profiling in Alamance County. They're hunting for a victim. It's nice when you look back at the end of the day and you see all the pieces come together. You don't actually see this, but it's happening to you. But at the same time, they're endorsing the sheriff's opponent. And we've got one of those emails in English and in Spanish. All right, so that continued. Newspaper got involved. I received telefaxes from the newspaper, a phone call from the newspaper asking me if I'd received my fax from the DOJ. That happened weekly. Then the phone would ring and my fax would come in. They tried to beat the sheriff up in the newspaper. They incorrectly quoted him by saying that their morals aren't the same as our morals, when the sheriff was absolutely correct when referring to gangs involved in human trafficking. And a judge picked up on that. He said he's not talking about Mexican people, he's talking about Mexican gangs. The DOJ then accused the sheriff of using racial epithets such as taco eaters and some too vulgar for me to repeat here. They tried to beat him up in the press with a fabrication that apparently came from someone who could not come up with a better racial slur at the time. So, we come to September 2012, we've been sued, we've been around five different judges, and the case was assigned to Judge Tom Schroeder. Within hours, I received a phone call from Mr. Songer, the DOJ. Said, Mr. Albright, we'd like to dismiss this case. So, okay, fine. And he dismissed it. Now, that case involved the declaratory judgment action, which said the sheriff deputies had to be represented when the DOJ was talking to them, which is the right we all have. And they dismissed the case, and in that dismissal, they produced a report that was short on facts and long on distortion. That report said that the sheriff was guilty of all kinds of things, and Tom Perez authored that report. We filed a reply to those allegations. I asked Mr. Perez to come down and meet with us. He didn't respond. And then the DOJ accused the sheriff of not cooperating with us in the investigation. I remember when Ms. Treppel and Mr. Saucedo came down to my office in June 15 of 2010. I know the sheriff remembers that day. We produced a roster of all the deputies. We said, here are our deputies. Who do you want to talk to first? Well, that's nice. We'll get with you tomorrow. Then they left and immediately began calling the deputies, began to call them and tell them they had to meet with us. That resulted in me having some hard words with them, and ultimately they filed their first lawsuit. Because they wanted to talk to the deputies. We didn't want the DOJ confronting a 19, 20, 21-year-old deputy and putting the pressure of the federal government on them. So I said, okay, if you don't want me in the room with you, let's hire an attorney, and they refused to do that. So they asked for thousands of documents, and we provided them. I know Tim Britt remembers mailing three times tens of thousands of pages of documents. Will you pass the bottle to me here? I got to try.
I didn't try. And they first claimed they lost them. They said we didn't get them. Well, Tim photographed them as they were put in the box and photographed the label. They said, oh, well, gosh, they must have been irradiated in our document examination. When they come into the mail room, they irradiate them, or they x-ray them, or do something. So, apparently, from the outcome of the trial, it looks like they never analyzed the documents. The judge picked up on that. The DOJ statements regarding the sheriff's position as to interviewing personnel said the sheriff refused. No, that's not what we did. We proposed that we would provide our deputies with outside counsel, and DOJ could continue with their investigation. But they felt so strongly about continuing, they told us they couldn't complete the investigation without interviewing the deputies, but they dismissed the first lawsuit. So apparently that wasn't a very strong argument for them, since they immediately dismissed it. Filed another lawsuit in December, the one we defended, and they failed to prove any of their allegations, none of them at trial. In fact, the only thing they proved was someone said a dirty word at the jail. Dirty word at the jail. And watched a inappropriate video that was sent to the jail early in the morning. I think it was about 2 a.m. on a Sunday morning. We think it's the Chapel Hill website it came from. About shoot the Mexican jumping over the border. A ridiculous game. But a jailer, early in the morning, bored out of his mind, played it for about 10, 15 minutes. Sheriff found out about it. Appropriate action was taken. That captain's no longer captain. He's still with the sheriff's office, but he's not a captain. He was demoted, and a punishment was appropriately handed out. And there's a new policy. You don't play games like that. And the sheriff's always had a policy, no racial slurs. In fact, in the discovery, most of the racial slurs are coming from the federal officers in the ICE program. Some of the words the sheriff and I never heard of, such as referring to a Hispanic as a tonk. I don't know what that means. And the sheriff doesn't know what that means. But the federal people explained to us that it's an acronym based on a form that they fill out. It's ridiculous. But the sheriff was accused of making that remark. Let's talk about traffic stops. They've done little statistical analysis on traffic stops. Everybody in this room knows that Alamance County has two lane roads. There's a big highway, and there's Church Street in Burlington, but every other road is a two lane road. So how in the world does a deputy at night determine that's a Latino driving that car? That was something that the judge was just appalled with. Their expert said, I had my man out there counting. He counted 15,000 times and didn't make a single mistake. The judge didn't believe it. The one of the exhibits in the opinion, and I've never seen this happen, a judge actually took one of our exhibits and put it in the opinion on page 77 when they're talking about traffic stops. Our statistics show that about 12% of them, 11% of the population of Alamance County is composed of Spanish-speaking people, and our traffic stops about 12%. So it's close. Our expert said there is no statistical evidence that the sheriff's doing anything wrong. Vehicle checkpoints. The DOJ alleged that Sheriff Johnson targets Latino neighborhoods to set up vehicle checkpoints. Well, now we know that those checkpoints are set up, and they would know this if they look at the records. They're done in conjunction with North Carolina Highway Patrol and other law enforcement agencies. That's how checkpoints are done. The governor's highway safety program, the click it or ticket program, booze it and lose it program. So that knocked that out. Checkpoint practices, they made allegations of misconduct there. The only evidence presented by the DOJ is an alleged unattributed statement made by Sheriff Johnson to his subordinates to go arrest a Mexican. And the judge looked and said, well, he's talking about drug dealers. Mexican drug dealers. What else should he call them? German drug dealers? The judge actually said that. Now, there were some humorous times in this trial. Don't get me wrong. When the expert from the DOJ, the mapping expert, produced a map of Alamance County without Gibsonville on it, I think everybody in the room got a laugh out of that. But this is the kind of thing they did to us. This is why it took so long. 63 depositions. They didn't use maybe 20 at trial, but they put us through it. And that takes time and that takes money. The ICE folks, jail booking procedures, they accused the sheriff of changing his booking procedures. ICE did that. And ICE in the audit was that they said he has the best program in the country. The best program in the country from the people that know about it. The drug trade. DOJ made an allegation that the sheriff illegally profiles Latino mobile home parks and neighborhoods. But interesting enough, the DOJ didn't make any allegation that the raids were not successful, and they were done in coordination with the United States Drug Enforcement Agency. It's in our documents. DEA sets them up, asks the sheriff to help him. And then the DOJ comes in and says, aha, you're targeting Latinos. Well, it also says something about the sheriff's ability to serve and protect
and they said the sheriff needs to do more community outreach. Well, I tell you, I've never seen a witness like the clerk from Green Lane, Miss McCall. That little old lady walked up to the witness stand, and she testified. And at the end of her testimony, she told about how the sheriff started a football program up there. The sheriff got a satellite station up there. We've got a deputy sheriff up there. Crime disappeared. They can walk the streets Sunday afternoon and not have to worry about drug dealers everywhere. When she got through testifying, the judge asked the DOJ, do you have any questions for this witnesses? And they looked down. And I walked up to escort her off the stand. She said, did I do well? I said, yes, ma'am. You don't hear them asking any questions, do you? And the judge believed her testimony. The sheriff's office responds to all calls, regardless of whether or not the caller is in this country legally or illegally. The only witness that testified at the trial for the DOJ that was a Latino was Mr. Arzola. Mr. Arzola was stopped. He couldn't remember who stopped him or why. Said he was stopped, showed his license. I said, well, he said the deputy or the officer, whoever it was, asked him, do you have any papers? He said, no. He said, well, okay, we'll carry your papers with you whenever you travel, and have a nice day. Went on about his way. And then he was asked the question, well, did you have any other experience with the sheriff? Yes, I did. My house was robbed. My wife insisted that I call the sheriff. I called the sheriff. He sent his men out there. They fingerprinted, they dusted, they canvassed the neighborhood. They did a good job. How do you feel about the sheriff, Mr. DOJ witness? He is an excellent sheriff. That's their witness. They said the Special Operations Unit performs traffic enforcement. Well, that's not quite true. The unit's composed of three divisions, vice, gang, and task force officers. And they primarily work with federal agencies doing law enforcement. All of these things are in our records. And concluding with this report, and I've tried to summarize 5 years into 5 or 10 minutes. We tried to reach a settlement with these folks. We said, look, we had a court-ordered mediation. We went to Raleigh. We said, we'll join Kayla. Is that it, Kayla? I pronounced that right. They refused. They said, you've got to sign our document or forget it. So we said, okay, we'll take our chances, trial. Judge Schroeder, in granting their motion to dismiss, some things stuck in my mind. He said the trial arguments were ambitious, and in this context, extraordinarily ambitious. They were factually undeveloped when discussing the evidence. That's what he called it, factually undeveloped. I've dealt with these folks, the DOJ attorney, since the initial meeting. Sheriff and I have cooperated with them from day one. We've given them thousands of pages of documents, Britt and Corporal Dockery scanned in probably 121,000 pages of documents so they could put it on their computer. And we did that. And we worked with our MIS folks, worked with their computer folks to make all that work so they could talk to each other, computer-wise. Bruce Walker produced exhibits for us at the drop of a hat. If we needed one, he did it. And Kirk Puckett, the man with the face for radio, delivered them to Winston-Salem. What I'm getting at is it's a real team effort. I'm proud to be part of it. We had nothing to hide. We told them we had nothing to hide. We believe to this day nobody did anything wrong. I believe that. They didn't prevail in their lawsuit because they just simply don't have the facts to prove their case. Their behavior investigating this lawsuit and the one before it runs directly against everything the DOJ proclaims it protects and defends. That's why this is so hard. If you look at the website, they've taken the American flag off of it. What does that tell you? I'll end this report with the question that I put to the DOJ at the beginning of this story. Sheriff and I in my office, and I talked to Ms. Treppel. I said, if there is a municipal law enforcement officer,
a highway patrol officer, or a sheriff's deputy that is allegedly violating the constitutional rights of the citizens of Alamance County, then why would you, DOJ, not provide the sheriff with the name of that person? Why won't you tell us who that person is? Why would you allow these alleged violations to continue for years while you investigate the sheriff's department? I told them several times that all they have to do is give this man a name of somebody doing something wrong, and that person will be unemployed. Then we'll hand them over to them. They never did. And here we are, almost two weeks from judgment in this case. They still haven't told us the name of that person. The investigation's over, the trial's over. So I'll try to answer any questions you may have.
Any questions?
Are we still applying to get the cost that we incurred?
Yes, we are.
Refunded?
We are indeed. The problem we're having, they sued us not under Title VI, but under 14-14-1, the Safe Streets Act. And there's just not any law in there that supports giving us our attorney's fees. We're trying our best to find some, or at least to make some plausible argument to that. We can get our costs back, which are substantial. But we'd like to get our attorney's fees back. I would like to get about 3,000 hours of my time and 2,000 hours of Mr. Pierce's time back.
What costs will they recognize off the top?
Well, it'll be deposition costs, transcript costs, cost of producing documents, those
sort of things. What about the manpower from the Sheriff's Department, those hours? Would that be part of what we
under,
try to go
under
after?
Under Title VI, if they'd sued us under that, it's pretty clear. We prevailing party gets attorney's fees and costs. But this Rodney King Act that they chose to sue us under doesn't provide for a lot of those things, but we're working on it, trying to figure out a way to do it. Right. I have already written to Mr. Brian Boykin of the DOJ in Washington, trying to get the sheriff's equitable sharing funds shaken loose.
That's my next question. Mm-hmm.
Because that is something that they withheld illegally.
How much is in that?
$1 million.
It's over $1 million. I wrote them a letter. I've asked for the exact amount. They have that number up there, but that is something that they told us, and I've been after them since they started withholding the money from the sheriff. Said, we're entitled to a hearing. If you make a decision to withhold this money, we are entitled under the law to a hearing. Give us our hearing. Their response was, well, we're not withholding it. It's just in abeyance. Abeyance.
What are they abeying?
Well, I asked him, I said, is that an island off the coast of Cleveland? What is abeyance? I didn't know. And so we had a conference call with him. I said, please explain that to me. And he said, well, the highest levels of the DOJ have said you're not getting that money. Okay, who are we talking about here? Eric Holder? The highest levels, DOJ. Well, now that the case is over, there's no reason for him to hold it in abeyance.
Right.
So we've started that process, but like all these other processes, I've learned that the law can say one thing, and it may take you a while to achieve that when you're dealing with the federal government.
Law telling you what to do.
And it took me about 3 or 4 months just to get to Mr. Boykin, and I still don't have his email address. I have a fax number for him, if he's still employed. A lot of the people that we've started our discussions with are no longer employed. We don't know where they are. So. We are making an effort.
One other question. The DOJ can appeal that decision, I understand.
They can.
And
if
what's the time frame they have to do
they
that?
They have 30 days.
All right. So
from
we'll know soon.
The 7th. We will. And
it's based on errors by the judge, isn't it?
Like, well, you have to have an error.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
And I've read this thing twice. And if you want to read some good legal opinion, I mean, this is one of the best, most thorough I've ever read.
So you're suggesting then that
there may not be a basis for appeal.
Right. It has to be an error of law.
Well, he took his time in doing what he was supposed to do.
Yeah. And Judge Schroeder is what I call a legal genius. I've read his other opinions. I told this board about a case we had at the same time this trial was going on. Right next door, we had a case with a gentleman who sued the sheriff. He was a guest at the hotel over there and claimed he didn't get the appropriate medical treatment. He lost. Our motion for summary judgment was granted. Judge Beatty issued his opinion. It was one page. It was two sentences. Motion granted. Case dismissed.
I'm sorry, would you also kind of explain the ruling of what without prejudice means?
And that's what this is with prejudice.
With prejudice, excuse me, I'm sorry.
It's over.
Can't bring it back.
Yeah. Can't bring it back. But Schroeder, 2 weeks later, he'd heard another motion for, I hate to say this, Jeff, but it's another one of your jail cases. That was the guy that sprayed himself with
money.
The guy that sprayed himself with life spray and accused you of Dane Bramage. Judge Schroeder wrote a 12-page opinion just to say case dismissed, but he covered every single element, and that's just the kind of judge that he is. I'm pretty confident if they want to try and appeal it.
So they're appealing the judge, not the case.
It's going to have to be an error of law.
Yeah.
He's going to have to have made an error of law. I didn't see it, but if they want to make that Fourth Circuit law and take that chance too, if the Fourth Circuit upholds his opinion, then it becomes the law of the circuit. Right now, it's just case. So there's a risk for them in doing that too.
Mr. Albright, we appreciate. Thank you for the job you did on this case.
Work.
You and Ben and staff and the attorneys, and we do appreciate right. that.
Well, sure. I had a good team. I had a good team. Every time I called Sheriff's Office, we would sit down many, many times at the drop of a hat to respond to things. But I got to tell you this, there's a young man over there, and he keeps telling me not to keep saying things about him, but, you know, Corporal, he's a corporal now. Call him Doogie, Mark Dockery.
Yeah.
He is a genius, and I'm not kidding. On page 77, this is the chart that Ben Pierce and the corporal prepared.
Yeah.
The judge saw fit to put it in his opinion.
Yeah.
And Mark took this information, analyzed it, and the judge, in talking negatively about McDonald's expert opinion, he said, hey, if this young man from Rockingham Community yeah. College can put this together, why couldn't you?
Yeah.
So.
Thank you. Mr. Oliver.
Thanks.
All right, County Manager's Report. You're in financial update.
Would like to recognize our finance officer, Susan Roberts, and she's going to give you a quick overview of where we're at with respect to our finances, which is actually in fairly good shape. So
that's good to hear.
Thanks.
Thank you.
And I promise this will be very brief. My report is only 5 pages.
Bless you.
Take 30 minutes.
Thanks.
On an evening meeting, $5 on a morning.
All right. Good evening, commissioners. I promise this will be very brief and very quick. The figures that I have before you tonight are as of June 30th, but they do not include our accruals. So this is where we stood actual without the accruals. As you can see, our percentage change in 14 was 2.81%, whereas in 15 we were at 3.6%. Budget amended was higher than the budget adopted. Revenue for fiscal year 13-14, we had collected 96% of what we had budgeted. I'm pleased to report that for 14-15, we've collected 98% of what has been budgeted. So we've got a 2% increase, and you can see those changes down here at the bottom. Our biggest one is, of course, sales tax, where we are up at 15%, and this one does not include the payments that we received in July and August for our May and June distributions. So those are the accruals that I was talking about earlier. Other licenses are up 13%. So overall, we are at that 2% increase. Expenses, we did the same in 14-15 that we did in 13-14. We've spent 95% of our budget over amended. So where do we stand at the end of the year? Revenues over expenses in 13-14, we were at $500,000 above. Right now, we have $2 million more expenses than we do revenues, but the accruals will play a big part in that. Other financing sources in 13-14, we were at a negative $116,000. For 14-15, we're at $3.4 million to the good. Majority of that is coming from the peak sale. So the net effect that you had for 13-14 was an overall increase of $387,000. And for 14-15, we have an increase of $1.4 million, and that is without the accruals. In 13-14, we added $5 million to fund balance, and I feel that we will add $5 million or slightly higher.
And that's due to the peak sale and accruals.
Right. The peak sale and the accruals are going to play a big portion of that, Commissioner Byrd.
So the fiscal year ending in June of 2015, mm-hmm. didn't we originally budget, and it was the previous board, I guess, taking $3.5 million out of fund balance.
Right. So and that was for the
accruals, we're $1.5 million ahead of that.
Right.
Well, now that 3.5 is applicable to the 15-16 budget that we had to balance. So these are, that figure is not reflected here.
Okay. Well, I thought drawing out of the fund balance was budgeted in both fiscal years.
It was, but we won't have to. Revenue will come in over expenditures, even what we budgeted.
Well, I understand. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Right. When we're looking at the budget, a lot of times it's you've got to find what is the board comfortable with in the gap that we need to fill between revenues and expenses, and that's where the appropriated fund balance comes in. So we're saying it for 15-16, we as a county and you as a board are prepared to spend $3.5 million from our fund balance. We're hoping that our revenues are still going to repeat that trend that we've seen the last few years, where they're coming in higher than the expenses that we had, and that's where we're going to be able to add to fund balance instead of using fund balance.
If we don't get hit with sales tax.
If we don't get hit with sales tax.
How about that $1.3 million we're going to lose?
Correct. Correct.
I think the House and the governor is going to take care of that. So that's what we're hoping. Any further questions?
All right, thank you.
Thank you,
Sue.
Appreciate it.
And the other thing I did want to mention is our strategic plan that we have scheduled for September 10th from 9 a.m. till 5 p.m. at the Grand Oaks Room at ARMC.
Right. So Grand Oaks Building.
Grand Oaks Building in the conference room.
It's in the big classroom, I think.
Yeah, but that is scheduled and confirmed for September 10th, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m.
Thank you. Any further?
Speaking of the sales tax, just real quick, I do want to thank Representative Ross and also our Representative Rydell for their help and also the work that our municipalities have put in this as well to lobby and to make sure that we're not one of those givers, one of those loser counties that Kevin spoke about. There's 17 counties that would lose from sales tax. We're one of the biggest. So that's all I have.
Thank you, sir.
We got the executive session.
This time, I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A4 to discuss matters relating to the location or expansion of industries or other business in Alamance County, including agreement on a tentative list of economic development incentives that may be offered in negotiations. I make that motion. I have a second.
Second.
I think we're now going into closed session.